human person as her worker, we have the Universal Declaration of Human Rights that the Article 1 say all human beings are equal in dignity and should act towards one another in a spirit of brotherhood. And the Article 25.1, everyone has the right to a standard of living adequate for the health and medical care, the necessary social service, sickness, disability, and social services. And the same article in the point 2, the motherhood and childhood are entitled to special care and assistance. Looking very far in the back, I asked if the history of her institution were always related to religion, because around 4,000 years before Christ, the temples were used as houses for the patient and handicapped. Ashoka Hospital, promoted by the Buddhism in India 300 years before Christ. In the ancient Egypt, the houses of life besides the temples. The ancient Greece, the Iatreion and the Asclepieion. The ancient Roma, the Valetudinarium for the time of war. And the Christianity, thus the monachism, eremite, and cenobite give medical assistance. The healthcare in the church. Medicine and healthcare in the Christianity, the Christian communities created the synodocium to receive the sick and the poor since the second to fourth century. Since the fourth century, the medical care moved from monastery to hospital. The Pope, as a curiosity, the Pope John the 21st is the only Pope ever who has a medical career alongside his work as a theologian. Later, at the beginning, in the 16th century, started the medical religious order for men and later on for women. Nowadays, the pastoral care as a faith education. Faith education. What means? At the beginning, we talk about catechesis. After, religious education, or Christian or Catholic education. The Vatican Second Council emphasized about faith education. My congregation is a congregation for education as the Jesuit move from religious education to faith education. That is good, well, very good for me, because being a doctor, I like to work in the hospital and not only to teach biology or physics or chemistry. What means faith education? A lifelong multidimensional process. That means helping each person to know and love Jesus Christ. Inviting to intimacy and communion with Him in and through the Catholic Church. In the 21st century, also involves helping learners understand their own faith, not only catechesis, but science and theology, harmony with faith and reason, so they can confidentially and respectfully engage with people of other religions or beliefs in ways to reflect God's love and plan for the world. In Paris, the first hospital was Hôtel Dieu, and in the United Kingdom, God's Hotel. I propose to consider three points. Firstly, God, faith. Second, the actors, health workers. And third, the patients. God. God, a father, the head of a big house or a big family, who loves every son and daughter, calling them by their own name, who enjoys with the fraternity, brotherhood among sons, equals and united, because love a brother is love him. God is always a transcendental mystery, the Most High, the Almighty, the Sacred, the One above every person, everything. God will always be the One who is present, close, provident, holy and merciful, yes. Misericordious. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. God did not send the Son into the world to judge the world, but that the world might be saved through him. God sent his Son, Jesus, and the mission of Jesus, with our eyes fixed on Jesus and his merciful gaze, we experience the love of the Most Holy Trinity. The mission Jesus received from the Father was that of revealing the mystery of divine love in its fullness. God is love. This love has now been made visible and tangible in Jesus' entire life. His person is nothing but love, a love given gratuitously. The relationship he forms with the people who approach him manifests something entirely unique and unrepeatable. The signs he works, especially in favor of sinners, the poor, the marginalized, the sick, and the suffering, are all meant to teach mercy. Everything in him speaks of mercy. Nothing in him is devoid of compassion. On the basis of this compassionate love, he healed the sick who were presented to him. The gospel of this morning was clear. Now, Jesus is not more with us. Now we are the Christ on earth as his body, the Church. Mercy is the real foundation of the Church's life. In virtue of their baptism, all the members of the people of God have become missionary disciples. All the baptizers, whatever their position in the Church or their level of instruction in the faith, are agents of the evangelization, and it would be insufficient to envisage a plan of evangelization to be carried only by professionals, while the rest of the faithful would simply be passive recipients, evangelium gaudium. And second, I won't consider the actors, the health workers. To receive God's love and to love him in return with the very love who is his gift brings forth in our lives and actions a primary and fundamental response to desire, seek, and protect the good of others. God's word teaches that our brothers and sisters are the prolongation of the incarnation for each of us. As you did it to one of these, the least of my brethren, you did it to me. Is the absolute priority going forth from ourselves towards our brothers and sisters? Evangelium Gaudium, 179. For that, we need a Christian identity. Christian identity finds its strength in testimony. There is no, we cannot attain the identity in a very short period of time. We too must make a long journey in our life, so this Christian identity may be a strong and pure testimony. Our identity is in imitating, in following this Jesus Christ, who is God Jesus to us. Faith is a gift of God that has entered us from God. It is God Himself who confirms us in Christ. And He has anointed us, placed the seal on us, provided us with a sure the pledge of the Spirit in our hearts. It is God who gives us this gift of identity, and the problem is to be faithful to this Christian identity and allow the Holy Spirit, who is our very guarantee, the pledge in our heart to lead us forward in life. The health worker mission is go out to meet, to listen, to bless, to walk with the people, and facilitate the encounter with the Lord. Be the Samaritan Church is the capacity of the Church and of every Christian to bear witness. Not proselytism, but attraction. Witness which attracts, which arouses people's curiosity. The good Samaritan is the one who had mercy on him. Go, say the gospel, and do likewise. Do present in this world the love of God who gave himself to humankind through Jesus Christ in a mission for the world. The health worker mission is heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse those who have leprosy, drive out demons. Freely you have received, freely give. He gave them power and authority to drive out all demons and to cure disease. And he sent them out to proclaim the kingdom of God and to heal the sick. The letter of James says, the prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well. The Lord will raise them up. Emphasize their expression of love, compassion, kindness, tenderness, mercy, comfort in all activities of care, inside, with healing, carried out by those who devote their lives to the service of health. The health worker mission, it has to do with bringing the gospel to the people we meet, whether they be our neighbors or completely strangers. This is the informal preaching who takes place in the middle of a conversation, something along the lines of what a missionary does when visiting a home. Being a disciple means being constantly ready to bring the love of Jesus to others. And this can happen unexpectedly and in any place, on the street, in a city square, during work, on a journey, on the health institutions. Remember, you may be the only Bible that others read. For me, my program is that, the letter of Paul to Timothy. Preach the word, be ready to do it, whether it is convenient or inconvenient. Correct, confront, and encourage with patience and instruction. The health worker mission, the first proclamation must ring out over and over, Jesus Christ loves you. He gave his life to save you. and now he is living at your side to enlighten, strengthen, and free you. Evangelium. The one who helps the sick and needy touches the flesh of Christ, alive and present in our midst. The third point is the patience. They are children of God. We should encounter the image of Christ himself in those who suffer. They are the flesh of Christ. The poor, the abandoned, the sick, and the marginalized are the flesh of Christ. Every person for us, and even more so in marginalized, is sick, is the flesh of Christ. We have to practice a holistic medicine. The need to look at the whole person, including analysis of physical, nutritional, environmental, emotional, social, spiritual, and lifestyle values. We have to pass from now evidence-based medicine to a personalized one. We are not a composite of five pieces. We are a unity completely integrated. The body, the mind, the emotions, the social, the spiritual. Who is God, the Lord for the patient? I ask that many times. There is not an idol to be at disposition of our wills. No someone to take off our sadness and sorrows. Not a magician to solve our problems. Not the God for our egoist calculus. When I accompany me, the patients to Lourdes every year with the malt order. We have very clear that the patient don't go to Lourdes to be healed, to be cured, but to accept the disease. He's the Lord of gravity, of the kingdom utopia. He's not acting directly in our lives. The lottery of life moves our lives. Many times, for me, the women say, my husband is died. God, take out my husband. No. The life puts your husband to the other side of the way. And there, God receives him. But he is always with us, with them. He does not send the disease. He does not punish us. We have to feel sense and not always guilty. Sometimes my disease is because I did. No. The challenge for me is that this God, the highest, the almighty, the sacred, above every person, is at the same time a father, the head of a big family, who loves every son by their name. And the challenge is to pass from the reverential love to the filial love, to make them to feel the sons of God. What kind of attitude of health workers we have toward the patient? It's a Chinese proverb that says, tell me I forget, show me I may remember, but involve me and I am understood. With medical practice, obviously, ethically right, love, tenderness, listening, dialogue, well information, informed consent, and various education. The homily of this morning talk also about education, not only medical education, but faith education. Pope John Paul II that coordination, harmony on a worldwide level would in fact allow a better proclamation and a more effective defense of your faith, or your culture, or your Christian commitment in scientific research and in your profession. Education in various, overall, values for life. And especially for the gynecologist, moral education, sexuality education. I like this majeutics. Is to take the people and to come to take out of them the good and the values they bring inside. Mater care values. The value of embryo, the value and limits of the reproductive health, the teaching of the Catholic Church about medical assisted reproduction, the value of pregnancy, the value of the birth out of mother anthropology. Mother anthropology is very materialist and very economicist. See? The fetus has an economic value to produce later on for the city. The value and limits of research, the value and limits of personal autonomy, and many others. The embryo, when started the human life, WHO defined the pregnancy when the blastocyst is implanted. Don't, before, there is no pregnancy. And that is very confusing. The church, the pastoral care, has to teach how to hold the conscience in order to make the decision according to the one right and Catholic conscience. The church does not intervene in the area proper to medical science itself, but rather calls everyone to ethical and social responsibility for the action, dignitas personae. Our hospitals today are the temples of science and technology, and there are no centers on the sick persons, but over other interests. Many times the research go over the person, over the sick. The question is, we have to do everything that the science and technology offer to us? We ought to do this that will be to serve the people and the sick. But many times we have to stay in a democratic disagreement, living in a conscientious suggestion where many determinations attempt the Christian values, going against the Christian vision of men and of life. Orchestrate a maximal ethics as the one promoted by our faith, with a minimal ethics as the one promoted by the society, in order to live together is not easy. Conclusion. We have to practical medical excellence. We have to be excellent academically, ethically, a Christian. In conclusion, for us health workers, Christian of today, there is a powerful call to prayer, to faith, and to witness. To be men of witness, St. Francis used to tell his brothers, preach the gospel at all times, and when necessary, use words. An authentic witness is one that does not contradict by behavior and lifestyle what is preached with the word and talk to others. This prayer by praying, announce the faith by believing, offer witness by living. And thanks for listening.